publicly anywhere. Rather, you should mail the concerned authorities or the concerned companies in a bug track or bug bounty programs, or you can mail them on their help email IDs. Moving ahead with the examples of the vulnerabilities, as I said, vulnerability is anything that exposes a weak point of the application. It's a lack of input validation on the user input. It could be lack of sufficient logging mechanism at the application level, be it a front-end application or a back-end application. It could also be because of a failover error handling, meaning whenever you print some error messages, you should not print out the entire log or stack trace to the end users, and not closing database connection properly. Even this is also a major point of vulnerability because the attacker can get the access to the database and he can misuse the data. Moving ahead, this slide covers slightly a trend of what the software development has been over the past decade. Back in 90s, all the business logic used to sit on the database side. Most of the business logic was coded in terms of the procedures or the SQL procedures, stored procedures and functions. And later on, as the days passed, people started building Java-based applications, but they were not yet on the over the internet yet, because the internet was just developing back then. They were more towards a small UI-based application, and they directly communicated with the backend. And later on, in the past decade, I would say microservices are everywhere in the market. Most of the legacy applications which were not using microservices are now being migrated to use microservices. That is one trend. And one more trend is older code was never expected to be accessible from the internet. But right now, if you see, most of the applications that you see are single page applications built using latest JavaScript based platforms like Angular, React, Bootstrap, Electron, so on and so forth. And speaking about JavaScript, it's not only on the client side. It used to be on the client side in 2000s. But right now, if you see, JavaScript sits on the server side as well with Node.js. And these paradigms are affecting the security in a way that you have to update the way you build the applications and the way you secure those applications with the latest building paradigms. Moving on to the next slide. What are these top 10 vulnerabilities that OWASP encourages support? They advocate these top 10 vulnerabilities because firstly, they are globally recognized. I'll later talk about how the OWASP collects and marks these as the top vulnerabilities across all the users. It's a standard awareness document for developers and web application security engineers. It represents broad consensus about the most critical security risks to web applications, meaning like web applications are everywhere now. And the consensus of all the security risks that most of the applications are vulnerable to are represented in a consensus manner here. Companies should adopt this document that are listed in the top 10 and start process of ensuring that their web applications minimize these risks. Changing the software development culture within one's organization towards producing more secure code. This is advocated by OWASP. Moving ahead, injection is one of the basic and the first OWASP vulnerability. Injection flaws such as SQL, NoSQL, OS, and LDAP injection occur when untrusted data is sent to an interpreter as a part of command or query. It's as simple as saying when the user input is expected from the application, but the user misuses the vulnerabilities present on the application and tries to gain access. We'll see more about the injection vulnerabilities later on. And to prevent these injection vulnerabilities, there are so many methods that the APIs themselves have developed. Like, for example, in SQL, Java, if you see, previously, there were basic structure of queries, and then you had to execute them one by one. And the query has itself was supposed to be formulated in an entire string along with the data itself. But nowadays, if you see, we have prepared statements instead of that, wherein the data can be dynamically inputted into the query string. We'll see a demo on this as well in the later of the session. Nowadays, ORM frameworks are famous everywhere. For example, Hibernate framework, which provides a bridge of connecting the application towards the database directly. So you can just call the update functions. You can do all the CRUD operations like create, read, update, and delete. All of the operations could be performed just by calling the inbuilt APIs, which are developed with more security intentions. Input validation is something that should happen in most of the scenarios. If there is no input validation, then you can easily say that the application is not secure. Escaping special characters and inputs is the most critical thing, which more critical or more basic thing, which SQL injection talks about, which we'll see in the later of the slides as well. As you can see here, the example scenario. Here you can see in the Java language, we have a string here, which is query. And in the query, you're directly substituting the value of customer ID, select start from accounts where customer ID is equal to some value. What is that value? It's request.getParameterID of ID, get parameter of some ID. Now, the problem with this is the attacker can input any data in this place. What is not clear? Can you guys hear me okay? Jaidu sir, can you hear me? Okay. I see most of the SS in the chat, so I think it should be okay. I'll proceed now. In this scenario, you can see that instead of the place where request.getParameterID is passed, if the attacker inputs the values as this, like let's say ID is equal to colon or 1 is equal to 1. In SQL, 1 is equal to 1 is always true because that is the basic statement. And since there is an OR here, this previous condition of ID is equal to so on and so forth is never checked. We'll see an example of this. We'll see a demo of this instead later on in the session. The second vulnerability that OS talks about is broken authentication. Application functions related to authentication and session management are often implemented incorrectly. Authentication means you to validate the user whom he claims to be with the credentials that he provides. When authentication is not implemented correctly, it allows attackers to compromise passwords, keys, session tokens, or exploit other implementation flaws to assume other users' identities temporarily or permanently. What happens with this is a user, attacker behaves as another user who is authorized to access the application. With that, the attacker gains all the access to the application, and he can basically compromise the security of the application. A few of the examples for this is the first one, the basic one is most of the people, when they are introduced initially to the software world, they try to keep the passwords as the ones that are used everywhere almost. Like the first point says the password is set as password itself. I'm sure most of you might have already used this technique in your life as well. But that's a beginning point, I would say. And most of the human brains work in a similar way. And in this way, the problem with this is these are very easily compromised. And there is actually, if you believe me or not, there are actually, in fact, many repositories or the data sources where there are passwords of millions of passwords listed, which the attackers can access openly. They're made open source, and attackers can gain access to applications using those passwords. They are the most common passwords used in other applications. These type of attacks are called as brute force attacks. When the attacker tries to use the number of passwords to gain access to the application. And if you're aware of sessions in HTTP, web application development scenarios, There is something called as timeouts. If you're not setting a timeout parameter on the session, let's say a user is logged in and he does not log out and just closes the web browser. And let's say, especially if you're sitting in a public web-based, your voice is breaking. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah. Your voice is clear. I think most of the people it's clear. For some, I don't know. It's fine for me.
Thank you for confirmation. I'll proceed. And if session, I was talking about the session timeouts. If the session timeouts are not implemented correctly, the users, if they are not logging out, the next user that comes, or rather the attacker who comes and uses the system will gain access to all the accesses of the previous user, meaning like the attacker is the user itself here. So this is a main vulnerability, and the developers have to ensure that the session timeouts are implemented correctly. Moving on, sensitive data exposure. This is again one more vulnerability that OWASP advocates about. Many of the web applications and the APIs do not properly protect the sensitive data. What are sensitive data? Again, the data could be important to the business perspective or important to the private individual perspective. Like for example, let's say if you have a personal identifiable information, it could be any type of ID cards or the numbers or the addresses or the blood groups. It could be anything. And it could be even the health care related documents, the medical documents of the medical history of the patient, along with the personal information of the patient. It could be anything. If they're not protected properly, then the security is breached. Sensitive data may be compromised without extra protection, such as encryption or REST or in transit. Like most of the times when you're dealing with sensitive data, like for example, passwords or let's say company confidential documents, it's often recommended to categorize your data into what is more secure and what is not more secure, what is public, what can be exposed to the public domain, and what should never be exposed to the public domain. In the emails, especially in Outlook, there is a feature called private email, in which the end-to-end encryption is achieved if you send it as a private email. So the more confidential information like the passwords, if you are sharing by email, you should use the private email. The examples of this are like if you are using the passwords to store and storing them somewhere, and if you are not using a proper hashing function, then the passwords can be exploited easily. Like if you're not hashing the password and sending it across to the wire, and especially if the wire is not secured enough, let's say if the website is not HTTPS, if it's just HTTP, which means it does not have a TLS feature, then any person in the network can gain access to the HTTP based data that you're transferring towards the server and to and fro from the server. In this way, it's essentially a form of man in the middle attack, where the attacker will gain access to the communication data that you are transferring between the client and the server. And there is a feature in databases nowadays called encryption feature. If you encrypt the passwords or the credit card information within the database and not taking care of the masking scenario after the database, then again it's exposure of the data, because the credit card could be encrypted and stored in the database, but the moment you access it, it is again open to the public domain in the normal format. This is again a big vulnerability. Moving on, there's one more vulnerability called XML external entities. This essentially includes when you have an XML document, and within the XML document, you incorporate the content of other.
Can you show the last tip page once again?
Sure.
That's it. Thank you, sir.
No problem. And external entities can be used to disclose the internal files using the file URI handler, internal file shares, internal port scanning, remote control, remote code execution, and denial of service attacks. We can see a small example here. XML documents are very important because they are being used like along with the JSONs in most of the service oriented applications nowadays. Here you can see that the entity XSC system stands for that external XML entity, and it is included directly as an URI here. The attacker can get try to extract the data from the server with this particular entity. In the second scenario, you can see that the entity itself is an external URL, which again is a vulnerability because using this, the attacker can get access to the entire document. Like he can try to port the data towards that URL. In the third scenario, you can see that the URL is in fact towards the dev/random, which could be potentially an endless file. It again leads into a form of denial of service attack because using this file, it never loads. No matter which parser you use, you can never parse the XML document with this external entity. So these are the type of vulnerabilities that are related to external entities in terms of XML scenarios. Moving on. Next vulnerability that OWASP encourages about is broken access control. It talks essentially about restrictions on what authenticated users are allowed to do and often not properly enforced. Attackers can exploit these flaws to access unauthorized functionality and or data such as access other users' controls, accounts, or view sensitive files, modify other users' data, change access rights, etc. It basically talks about how the access, if not implemented correctly, then can lead to potential vulnerabilities. You can see an example here saying the application uses unverified data in SQL. Let's say you have something like this where TMT is called a prepared statement dot set string. You are setting the prepared statement string. Using prepared statement is good, but again, what you're doing there, you're setting the request, the value as request.get parameter of the account. So an attacker can directly modify the account parameter in the browser to send whatever the account number they want. And if not properly verified, the attacker can access any user's account. For example, like this, if the account is sent as not my account or any value, that value directly goes into the it goes into the prepared statement there. Coming to the second scenario, and most of you might have already seen this behavior when you want to navigate the user from one page to another page, then you often end up in redirecting the users. So there's a concept called forced browsers where you can target the URL, you can change the URLs by yourself. If you're not implementing the proper access rights to each of the users, you might end up giving the access admin access to a normal user, something like this. Let's say if you want to redirect the user to this particular URL, but the URL entered by the attacker is this, and if the access rights are not implemented correctly, then the attacker will get access to this admin page, which is again a flaw. Next up, security misconfiguration. This is the most commonly seen issues when the security is not properly configured. Like it could be in any manner. Like if the in servers generally, let's say if you are installing a base server, then you often see the directory listing. If you're not disabling it in terms of the company production server, then the entire directory structure would be exposed to the attackers. And even the attackers might get access to the codes that are there or the deployments that you have done in the server. And once he gets the access to the deployments, then he can reverse engineer the deployments to get access to the code base itself. And one more example is when the entire stack trace of the error message is printed out on the server. This I see in most of the cases, but often the developers have to ensure that there is no stack trace printed out across like this. And one more vulnerability is that the cloud service provider can sometimes enable the default sharing permissions of any documents that the users create open to the internet. This is again a major vulnerability, because if the permissions are not implemented correctly, any user can access get access to the document if he gets the access to the URL. I mark the words here, patched and upgraded in timely fashion. The configurations of the security must be patched and upgraded in a timely fashion, meaning whenever the vulnerabilities crop up, they must be implemented on the servers. For example, let's say you have a Unix server, or rather a cluster of Unix servers, and you want to upgrade them. What happens in organizations is you often have a application deployed across a huge cluster. And if you want to upgrade the server in which the application is deployed, you rather end up in stopping the application and applying the changes and then bringing up the application again. It is easier to say than doing, because most of the times it might lead to new changes, because you're not sure what are the new changes that are introduced by the new patch that you're applying. And most of the times it might even lead into the production issues on a huge scale at the organizations if it is not implemented correctly. Nowadays, most of the public cloud providers are giving their own options of upgrading the patches. Next one is cross-site scripting, in which the users from one website try to put their scripts in other websites, meaning the script could be a malicious script, which will be executed on a different browser in which it is not intended to. We can see an example to understand this better. You can see here that the input tag is having the name as credit card, type is text, that's all okay. The value is here request.get parameter of CC. Now here, the attacker modifies the CC parameter in the browser and he can insert the script there. What happens with this script is document.location is equal to the attacker's website. So when you submit the page, the entire document, entire cookie information of the entire page goes to the attacker's hand. This is one example of XSS attack, where the attacker's script is included in your website, which is not supposed to be the place. Yeah, moving on to the next one. Insecure deserialization. When you want to communicate with different services, you often end up in sending and receiving the objects. And the objects sending and receiving happens over a bite-sized serialized manner. And if you're not, while deserializing, if you're not taking care of the security scenarios, just validating the thing that you're deserializing, I mean the object that you're deserializing, then you might end up in giving the access to the attackers. For example, even if the deserialization flaws do not result in remote code execution, they can be used to perform attacks, including replay attacks, injection attacks, and privilege escalation attacks. Sometimes the objects and data structures related to the attack could be available in the application that can change the behavior of the application. It could be during the deserialization or after the deserialization. And these type of serialization deserializations are used everywhere in remote procedure calls, interprocess communication, wire protocols, web services, message brokers, and most of the databases, cache servers, file systems, and HTTP cookies as well. This is one of the examples scenario where the PHP session is stored, but when an attacker changes the serialized objects to give permission to themselves as an admin user. Essentially the attacker can modify the object value while deserialization and then claim the admin privileges by using this method. Next, using components with known vulnerabilities. Though the vulnerabilities of the security vulnerabilities of the components are widely communicated across, but some of the old component vulnerabilities will still be there and often very hard to upgrade. Like for example, IoT devices. You might see that the IoT devices are given out to the end users, and most of the times they may or may not have the access from the server. So in this scenario, it's very hard to upgrade the patches to those IoT devices. For example, it could be a healthcare based device, or it could be a small vulgar alarm system or anything like that. And in the application development scenario, struts 2 remote execution is a known vulnerability, but there are already known to be significant breaches in this component as well. Insufficient logging and monitoring. This is again a very important one, because if you're not logging what's happening in the application, no one can know how the application was compromised. It's as simple as that. Let's say the application is not having enough logs and no monitoring scenario. And one of the vulnerability that the attacker can use is, you can use the password, one common very known password. Let's say the password is equal to password example, and he can run it across all the users that are present in the system. Let's say he got the access to the users as well. In this case, what happens is, most of the times, if you're not logging it properly, or if you're not monitoring it properly, let's say if you're not monitoring the count of passwords that were hit on the servers across all the users, then you might end up giving the access to the attacker, because he may know with that particular password how many users can he access, or how many users can he enact. And this is often hard, because you for all the other users with the common password that the attacker tries, it will be marked as only one invalid or wrong attempt. But for the valid ones, he'll get the access easily. So proper logging and monitoring should be in place to ensure the security. Let's have a small demo now. I would like to introduce about the SQL injection in case of Java. I've built a small Spring Boot based application, and you can find the relevant code anywhere across the internet related to these concepts. Starting from the POM of the file, POM is basically a dependency management system where you have Maven dependencies listed here. In SQL, in MySQL based, have this MySQL connector Java, and I have Lombok for annotation based data processing. In the code, you can see that I have minimal connection there. I have a DAO called user, which has username and password. And I have a server which gives me access to the users. I have two methods here. One is get users, and one is get users securely. Okay, I think you're not able to see the screen. I'll quickly change the. Are you able to see now? Okay. Right now, I have a normal service, in which the users can be accessed either using the old methods or using the new method. And I'll try to run this application and see what happens. When I run the application, the main method will be called. Most of you who know Java might relate to this already. I just have a while loop here, which prompts the users to input the options. Initially, I'm asking for the service. Let's say one stands for normal query and two stands for prepared statement. And once the user selects the version, then I'm asking the user to enter the username and password, and I'm trying to query the database and verify. I have made a connection to database here. You can see that I have a small table in which the columns are just ID. Now I've done the application. See that, you can see that it's prompting the user to enter the service version. Let's say I'll first proceed with the normal query, enter the username. As you guys can see here, one of the user is user one. I'm entering user one, and then the password is password one. Okay, it just says that the login is successful. And user data are prompted here for just for demo purpose. Let's see what happens when the user inputs the values differently. I'm just demoing the command line version of it, but this could be a normal UI as well, wherein you have a username box and you have a password field as well for that, and you enter the passwords. Let's say I'm using a normal version again, and I enter username as normal user, okay? But the password, I'll not enter it as password. I'll enter as anything that I want. And along with that, I'll add one more small clause saying anything or 1 = 1. You guys can see this. It just says that the password can be anything or 1 = 1. As you can, as I told you previously as well, in SQL, 1 = 1 will always be true, and true or anything is always true. Anything, I mean, it could be the previous execution result could be true or a false. So let's see what happens with this. See, login successful, and the attacker got access to usernames and passwords of all the users that are existing in the database. Can you see this here? This is the database table, and this is the log statement that I just printed. This is the log statement that I printed here are essentially the results. If you can see here, the get user is returning the users, and I'm just logging the users. So if the attacker is getting access to this API called get users, and if he passes the query as per to match the attacking scenario, then he'll get access to all the users. Let's see what happens in case of in another case. I'm using normal query again, and in user I'm entering as user one because I know that the user one is already existing in the system, and but I don't know the password. Let's see what happens. In this case, I'm entering in user's place as user one, or it could be any number. Let's say 9 = 9, which is always true. And when I enter this, it asks for password. I don't know the password right now, right? So I'll just enter as anything again, or ABC. You see, the login successful. Even though I entered a password which is not existing in the database, can you see this here? There's no password here, which says as ABC. But even though I've entered as password, the password as ABC, I got access to the user. I mean, I'm able to access the system because the login is successful, and even I can get the user details as well. So I'm essentially saying that the vulnerability could be exploited even from the user name perspective or the password perspective. Let's see how to secure this. To secure this, we can use something called as prepared statement, which is an API provided by JavaSet. In the query service, if you go, the securely method is there, right? That implements the statements using prepared statements. The advantage of using prepared statement is you can have a query in which the values are masked in this scenario. Let's say you have username equal to question mark. It is not entirely substituting the value here directly in the query string itself, but it substitutes the values later on with the prepared statement set string method. So let's see what happens in this scenario. I'm entering 2 here, which stands for prepared statements. And then let's try to mock the previous vulnerability that we just exploited. And I'm entering user 1 and 9 = 9, which is same as before. I'm entering password as ABC, which is same as before. But you see, this time I got it as wrong username and password, meaning this way of implementing the prepared statements or using the prepared statements to execute the SQL queries is more secure, and we should use it. We can also try to mock the previous case wherein you had the user's access, but you didn't know the password. You didn't know either the user and the password. Let's say the user could be anything. Let's try to mock the previous case, and then we'll see. I'm entering the user as user one. Sorry, I had to enter 2, but I entered user. I'll just repeat it. Just to recap, I had previously entered the username as user one, and in the password I had entered as anything or 1 = 1 and got the access. I'm entering 2 here, and username I'm entering as user one, and the password I'm entering as anything or 1 is equal to 1. Let's see. In case of the second scenario, it gave the result as wrong username as password. So you cannot essentially use the vulnerability present in terms of the string query formats here. Someone asked me if it is PyCharm or what ID it is. It is IntelliJ IDEA. I'm using its community edition, I think. Yeah. Moving on with the presentation, I'll quickly stop sharing and share the second screen. Okay. Now that you saw the demo, the entire code is available for your trial and error. I've uploaded this on the GitHub, and this is the link. The slides will be shared with you, and you're free to check out the code and experiment with the vulnerabilities. Now let's talk about application security risks. What are the application security risks that are present in the application that the attacker can access? It could be any type of risk. Let's say the attacker, the threat agent essentially tries to use any one of the streams, or the called also called as attack vectors, and then they just need to get through one of the weakness that the application has, and then they get access to the controls, and they change the default behavior of the technical functionalities and impact the entire business. Attackers can potentially use many different paths through the application to do harm to your business or organization. There are standard ways of calculating the application risk, which are listed here. These are also present in the OWASP website. I would strongly encourage you guys to go through them. For developers, OWASP generally proposes that the security should be incorporated in all the stages, be it the requirement analysis stage or the development stage or the architecture stage. There's something called a secure web development lifecycle, in which you can encourage people to follow the secure security concept in all of the stages of the development lifecycle of the project. And there is something called as application security education, in which they encourage all the organizations and all the educational institutions to teach the students about, or to teach the employees about, the security vulnerabilities that are present across the world, so that when they develop applications or when they use the system applications, they'll come to know what to do and what not to do. And there is a plan of updating the entire existing top 10 vulnerabilities data with the 2020 vulnerabilities. The goal is to collect the latest vulnerabilities that are present in the current world. We just spoke about 10 of them, right? So there is an ocean of other vulnerabilities which are listed under OWASP website. I encourage you guys to check them out. We actually discussed about one or two of them here, just the 10 of them here in the presentation. That's it from my side. Thank you. Daniel, sir, over to you. Dele sir, are you there? I think you're on mute.
Hello, Chetan.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think Jadavar is. Yeah, he has come. Yeah.
Chetan, thanks a lot for your informative talk. And apparently, Sana is not online.
Yes, sir. I think she is.
Yes, sir. I'm on.
Thanks a lot once again, Chetan. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Sir, Zahana, can I start?
Yeah. Sure.
Zahana, can I start?
I'm sharing my screen. Yeah.
The next speaker is Sahana. Sahana is a security engineer. Her main focus is on binary security, and she works on database tracking and testing, which can automatically detect and prevent vulnerabilities. Prior to joining Facebook, She graduated with master's in cybersecurity.
Hello, Jaita sir. Hello. Sir, we are unable to hear you, sir.
Okay. Hi.
Was it audible?
Is it audible?
Hello?
Are you audible? Okay.
Hello. Hello.
No. Hello. Can't you hear me, sir?
Hello.
Tahana, we can hear you. We can proceed now.
Okay. Hi all. I'm Tahana. I'm a security engineer at Facebook. I work on.
Sahana,
native...
we are unable to hear you.
Hello.
Please check your mic.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
And I think you're audible. Can you continue?
Don't seem to. Hello. Hello.
She has started. I think she has not started.
Hello.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, please.
Okay. I'll continue the presentation then.
Yes, is it the second session? It's the first session, right?
The first session was broken down into two parts. This is the second part.
Okay, do you want me only one single recording to be uploaded or two different recording? Please let me.
Anything is fine, whatever you do.
Okay, fine. Shall I mix one single recording itself? Okay.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, you can continue.
Okay. Okay. So is it clear now? Am I clearly audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay. Let me share my screen quick. Okay. Just a minute. Okay, can everyone see my screen? Okay. Hi everyone, I'm Sahana. I'm a security engineer at Facebook.